Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I am Vandana Hari, Asia Editorial Director. Power, coal and diesel, all three are inextricably linked in the Asian markets, and especially so in the emerging giants of China and India. That connection came to the fore in recent months when India's poor monsoon and resultant power shortages exerted a major pull on gasoil, driving up premiums in the benchmark Singapore market. The situation reminded one of end 2010, when a power shortage in China briefly flipped the country into a net gas oil importer and tightened supplies of the middle distillate in this region. So what exactly happened this summer? To look at the coal and the diesel angles of the story, I have with me in the studio today Jimmy O Connell, our senior managing editor for coal, and Jonathan Nonis, our gas oil editor. Jimmy, let me start with you. India is having to fall back on gasoil-fired generator sets. Whatever happened to electricity from the grid? The country was supposed to be adding nearly 100 gigawatts of capacity, if I'm not wrong, through ultra-mega power projects. Did they not pan out?
Well, each of those ultra-mega power plants was supposed to be 4 gigs. And when the plan was originally conceived 7 or 8 years ago, it was expected that they would have at least half a dozen on by now, and that they would, in fact, have lightened the load somewhat entirely on the grid. However, that's not the case. We've only seen two even start. We've got one coming online by the end of the year. Conversely, that's actually based on domestic coal supplies. And one other that has a couple of units up, but not fully ramped up to the full capacity of the 4 gigs yet.
So what happened? Were tariffs a problem? Were coal supplies a problem? Where does one start looking at this whole equation?
That's a very good question. I think everything is a problem almost at the moment. We're talking about low tariffs that were awarded at 2.5 rupees or so in the region per megawatt hour, extremely low awards at a time when coal prices were at least half of where they are right now. So that's one fundamental issue. A second fundamental issue is that they've not been in a position to import as much coal as they were hoping to, despite the fact that imports have gone through the roof. And also to go back domestically for a moment, whilst they've got huge reserves of coal, in billions and billions of tons of reasonably middle quality thermal coal, they've just had serious problems producing it, getting it out of the ground. And when they do get it out of the ground, they have problems transporting it. And that's one of the main reasons why the UMPPs were actually based originally around the coast.
Let's go back a moment to tariffs. Clearly there was a mismatch between the tariffs and the coal prices at that time when the projects were awarded and now. How do you see this going forward? Do you think the tariffs could be renegotiated and bring the projects back on the ground?
Well, already one specific project has been shelved for that very reason. It's supposed to have been finished by the end of this year, and now that UMPP isn't even being included in the next 5-year plan. So I think that's an indication that something needs to happen. They have a system where twice a year current tariffs are very minutely tweaked. I think it needs a complete overhaul. I think that they need to be a bit more realistic. They need to understand that prices have basically doubled of coal in the international market, and they need to appreciate this. And if they really want their power to get back on track, if they want to eliminate brownouts or the blackouts that we've seen in recent weeks and months, they really have to tackle the situation and cut out some of the red tape and cut straight to the heart of the action, and that's really renegotiate the tariffs.
So growing imports does expose India to the international market prices. Is growing import dependency also a problem?
India is running neck and neck with China at the moment in terms of import demand. They've actually created a completely new system in international coal flows, both in terms of where the coal is coming from and also in terms of the quality. For example, Richards Bay, which is in South Africa, used to be one of the main exporters to Europe. And now India, Korea, China have changed that trade flow entirely. 80% of exports from South Africa are flowing to Asia. But it's not only South Africa, it's Indonesia, and a lower quality coal is coming from there as well. So what we have seen is imports go through the roof, yet that's just not enough to keep the power grid going. And we've seen a new market develop for slightly lower calorific value coal as well.
So the coal is available at a price, of course, in the overseas markets. But is the infrastructure there to move it to the power plants?
Well, in the last couple of years, the ports have developed to take the largest size of ship that coal is carried on the high seas, and that's a Capesize vessel. Primarily, India's ports are designed to take Panamax vessels. Now, that's fine. Freight is slightly higher, but it's something that can be accommodated in the global scheme of things. I think it's domestically that the real issues are. And we alluded to this earlier on in the reason why UMPPs are based around the coast. But whether it's in terms of improving the rail network itself, getting more wagons online, and also improving communication. Because the coal is there, it needs to get out of the ground. There needs to be clarity of communication between the miners, the railways, and the end users. That would help things a lot.
So quite a complex web, and we'll come back to coal and China shortly. But before that, Jonathan, let me ask you, the power shortage problem in India created a big pull on gasoil supplies in the region. What did you observe in the summer months?
Well, we saw record high premiums for the medium sulfur grade. It was about $3.15 above Singapore quotes, and that's a four-year high, really. India specifically was out in the market buying spot cargoes to supplement its demand. We saw exports of gasoil out of India from the two major refiners also shrinking on a month-to-month basis during the summer period. India bought about, IOC, the country's largest oil marketer, bought about 240,000 tons of oil, gasoil, in the last 3 months for June, July, and August.
Which is unusual for the company?
Yes, it is. Usually IOC buys from internal sources, bound to themselves, with Essar Oil or Reliance. So for them to come out and buy from the spot market, international spot market, was not common, but not that rare either. So they purchased those cargoes at very high premiums of around $7, $8 compared to where we were trading at $3.50 to secure those cargoes.
Now, India has a major and expanding refining infrastructure of its own, and it's a gasoil exporter as well. So was the country importing and exporting gasoil at the same time?
Yes, it was. In fact, because prices were so high in Asia, some of the oil marketers took advantage and sold additional spot cargoes, but those were high sulfur gas oil and not what India requires, which is medium sulfur gas oil. So we had MRPL, for example, selling 3 cargoes a month in July and or August. So because the market because there was so much demand around the region during the summer, premiums were at 3 year four highs, 3 to 4 year highs. India was buying, Saudi was buying, the Middle East was buying in the whole. There's still strong demand here in Singapore as well, and it's continuing going forward for high sulfur gas oil as well. Yes.
Tell us a little bit about India's typical summer gas oil demand peaks, and do you think the poor monsoon this year exacerbated the situation?
Every time there's the monsoon, there is higher demand. And so for this period, when the monsoon was late, what happened was a lot of, from retail to large industries to agriculture, there was more dependent on gasoil generating power generators. And we saw that with the higher demand and that imports from India. Farmers were using diesel generators to draw up water from the ground. Factories were using generators, diesel generators, just to continue their production. In fact, I believe there was a report out a couple of weeks ago saying that because of the black-ins and blackouts in India, power outages, that's going to affect their GDP by almost 5%. So that's not a very good thing to have. So power security is very, very, very important for a country's GDP growth.
Surely. And the country also has huge gas oil subsidies. Do you think that played a role in this summer's complex problems as well?
Definitely. So in India, you know, gasoil prices for petrol is about 74 cents a litre, while gasoline prices are probably about $1.10. And that's because gasoil prices are subsidized. So what happens is you see that year-on-year growth demand for gasoil has risen on the back of not power demand, but on the back of petroleum fuel, car fuel, basically. Whereas if you see the gasoline trend, the gasoline demand has been pretty much flat. So, you know, car buyers have gone to buy diesel cars instead of gasoline cars.
Jimmy, we were talking about India and coal. Let's take a look at China and the coal situation. Do you think the country managed its power and coal supply situation better this summer?
Well, not only this summer, but over the last number of years as well in developing its infrastructure. Now, this summer, the government came out as long ago as 5 or 6 months ago and said that the annual shortage in the summertime in China is around 35 gigawatts. But the government came out and said that this year they've got so much stocks, hydro is doing so well, that they're looking at a summer shortage of about 25 gigawatts, so down by about a third. Over the last 10 years or so, we've seen China develop its infrastructure, both in terms of mining and in terms of power plants themselves. We've seen them add about 60 gigawatts a year, which is the equivalent of the UK's power, for example, which is a phenomenal building program. And we've also seen them come from producing 1.2 billion tons of coal a year 10 years ago to producing around 3.5 billion tons of coal a year, just over 3.5 billion tons, and that's about half the coal that's produced in the world in its entirety.
But they need imports as well, don't they?
They do. And that's the funny thing, because despite the fact that they've got these phenomenal building programs, they've dipped in and dipped into the international markets and turned into a net importer from being a net exporter for decades. And this happened only in the last in the last 4 years. 2008 was the turning year in that respect. And it's thrown a serious cat among the pigeons in the international market, because you had trade flows going, as we mentioned earlier, from South Africa up to Europe, and they were all established and it was the traditional pattern. But now you've got a 200 million ton a year demand coming from North Asia. So we're seeing a lot more production in Indonesia. We're seeing an entirely new market develop in Australia. And they're also taking a lot of South African coal. And just briefly, I want to highlight the market in Australia because it's really indicative. There's a premium quality coal that is now mainly only used by the Japanese, and it's the current benchmark. Plats have developed a higher ash, which is a slightly lower calorific value coal product. And it's becoming really, really popular in the market simply because it identifies a need. It shows that the Chinese and the Koreans primarily are becoming far more price sensitive. It's a slightly cheaper product in terms to produce, so that's good for the miners that are suffering high costs. But also it's indicative that, you know, there is an economic slowdown and cheaper prices, commodities are very much welcome in the industry.
So China is taking a lot more coal. Is it also taking coal resources and equity in such projects overseas?
Absolutely. They've been extremely active in the M&A market, both in Australia and in Indonesia. We've seen them buy up everything from plots on the ground to fully fledged miners. And that's another area where they've really taken the lead on in India. Australia has been described sometimes as China's quarry. India, the International Coal Ventures Overseas Committee, have a huge war chest, have loads of money to actually spend on projects, but they haven't actually achieved one. Steel Authority of India was part of this group, and so was Coal India Limited, the largest miner in the world. And SAIL have pulled out, and Coal India are allegedly pulling out as well. So it's kind of falling to bits in that respect. They've lots of money, but I suppose red tape again is preventing them from actually being swift or quick to the punch. And they keep getting beaten by China in this respect.
So plenty of coal supplies in China, basically. And Jonathan, did we see that have an impact on the gasoil consumption of China as well?
Well, it's been reversed compared to India. In fact, China's demand has fallen. And in the recent data, July's demand is 1.3% lower than last year's demand. Mm-hmm. And that's on the back of, you know, poor economy, slowing down of the economy, basically. the industry is not using as much gasoil as it used to. However, you know, we do note that there has been a drawdown in some supplies in August, down about 8% compared to July. So it's not all doom and gloom in China, you know, but the country is no longer dependent on gasoil for power or so on and so forth. In fact, you know, China's recently, just in the last 2 months, has become a net gasoil exporter, mm-hmm. Compared to being a net importer earlier this year.
That's all we have time for today in this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. Thank you very much, Jonathan and Jimmy, for joining me. We hope to see you again soon.